Hi everyone, it's Dr. Lisa Schwartz, and today I want to talk about the controversies around dairy, how it relates to breast cancer and some other issues. Now, there's something about cow's milk that ignites a passion on the order of religious zealotry as to whether it's a protein and calcium-filled goodness that's been consumed as a healthy beverage for centuries, or the one animal product that for sure will give you cancer, heart disease, and Alzheimer's, and maybe cause you to grow an extra limb where it shouldn't be. Well, usually neither side of that debate is well equipped with the facts. So let's start with some facts about milk. Number one, milk is a mixture of fat globules in a water-based fluid that contains carbohydrates, proteins, and minerals. Now, all of this makes it an ideal fuel for growth, which is why mammalian babies are fed milk. Number two, the carbohydrate or sugar in milk is called lactose. Number three, whole milk contains about 3.4% total fat. The fats found in milk are predominantly saturated and monounsaturated. Four, the protein in cow's milk is about 82% casein and 18% whey. Now, these particular proteins contain all 9 essential amino acids. Amino acids that are essential cannot be made in the body and must be consumed in the diet. 5, milk also contains a host of vitamins and minerals, not the least of which are vitamin D and calcium. So those are the background facts on milk. Now let's get to the good things about milk first. What are the benefits attributed to milk consumption? Well, one, it's a great source of protein, vitamins, and minerals, as I mentioned before. And two, it contributes to general bone health by supplying calcium and vitamin D. In fact, it's a great source of calcium, and adequate consumption of calcium is important throughout life. You see, most of the body's calcium is stored in the bones, but there's a certain amount of calcium that needs to remain in the bloodstream so that cells can function properly. When the blood calcium runs low, the bone storage provides the needed calcium and releases some of its store into the bloodstream. Now, this can lead to weaker bones in the long run, but if you consume adequate amounts of calcium and vitamin D, then the calcium in the bones is left in storage. The exception to this may be postmenopausal women, where bone loss from lack of estrogen exceeds intake. Now, in some studies involving older populations, dietary supplementation with calcium and vitamin D has led to fewer fractures. Now, you could take supplements or even eat other foods containing calcium, but the calcium found in milk has greater bioavailability, meaning it's more easily absorbed than calcium from vegetables or fortified foods. And now we get to the part you've really been waiting for. What are some of the concerns with milk? Well, first of all, should you be drinking whole milk or skim milk? Well, current thinking is whole milk. The fats that are in milk are predominantly saturated fats, which have gotten a bum rap over the years. However, we now know that not all saturated fats increase your risk of cardiovascular disease. So in skim milk, most of the fat has been skimmed off the top, although the process is really more complicated than just letting the cream rise to the top. Well, then you need to add back vitamins A and D because they're fat-soluble vitamins and they get skimmed away with the fat. And producers also add some milk solids that give it a thicker consistency so that it's thicker than water, which sounds really yummy, right? Now, the fat that's in whole milk leaves you feeling more sated and less hungry than with skim milk. There's some research that folks who consume whole fat actually weigh less and are less likely to develop diabetes. So in most cases, whole milk is going to be the better choice. Now, some people avoid milk because of an allergy or sensitivity to it. A true allergy to milk, it occurs in about 1% of the population. It's a little more common in children, and it can be outgrown. But it does indeed exist, and if you have a true allergy, then you do need to avoid milk. The thing that's more common is a sensitivity to milk or lactose intolerance. Now, the sugar in milk is lactose, and the enzyme that you need to break it down is lactase. Now, as some people age, they produce less lactase, so they don't break down the sugar in milk, and they end up with GI symptoms such as gas and diarrhea. Well, other factors can play a role too. For example, the proportion of the population that's lactose intolerant is dependent on ethnicity to some extent. It's slightly more common in those of Asian and African descent. And also, symptoms may not occur unless you consume more lactose than the lactase produced by your body can handle. So this means that most people with lactose intolerance can actually consume up to about 8 ounces of milk without problems, and more if they consume the milk with other food. Cheeses and yogurt have lower levels of lactose, and those can be tolerated as well. So now let's talk about hormones. And again, it's time for more facts. Number one, cows produce growth hormone naturally, but some dairy producers administer extra growth hormone to cows to increase milk production. So far, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, the World Health Organization, and the National Institutes of Health have reported that the supplemental hormones given to cows are safe for human consumption at the amounts present in milk. Now, two, the hormone known as recombinant bovine growth hormone has been banned in the EU, Canada, Australia, Japan, and New Zealand because it increases the risk that a cow will develop mastitis, not because of health risks to humans. Thirdly, organic milk in the U.S. is produced from cows who have not received supplemental growth hormones. In fact, only about 17% of dairy cows in the U.S. receive supplemental growth hormones. And four, all milk contains minuscule amounts of the naturally occurring female hormones, estradiol and progesterone, but much, much less than women have in their bodies naturally. And consumption of milk does not appear to affect blood levels of those hormones. And drumroll, please, milk consumption has not been linked to breast cancer. In fact, in one recent review, there was an inverse relationship between dairy consumption and breast cancer. And for another big misconception, there are no antibiotics in milk. Dairy cows are treated with antibiotics only when they're sick. They're separated from the herd, and their milk is discarded until the antibiotics have cleared their system. All milk must test negative for antibiotics. Antibiotic use in animals used for meat production, however, is a different story. So what have we learned about milk? Number one, cow milk is a great source of protein, vitamins, and minerals, especially calcium and vitamin D. Number two, organic milk in the U.S. comes only from cows that have not received supplemental hormones. Thirdly, there are no antibiotics in milk. And fourth, the estrogen and progesterone levels in milk are very minor and don't affect blood levels of hormones. So I hope this has cleared up some of the controversy with dairy. If you're interested in more information about breast cancer, nutrition, and healthy lifestyle changes, well, be sure to visit my website and blog at lisaschwartzmd.com or subscribe to my YouTube channel at lisaschwartzmd. Thanks for your time and attention. I'll see you next week.